We'll be looking at the next psychrometric property, which is called the wet bulb temperature. And in order to understand wet bulb temperature, we start with a process called adiabatic saturation. Now, let us try to understand this from a very practical standpoint. All of you are familiar with desert coolers, right? In summer, all of us have seen or used desert coolers. What happens in a desert cooler? What is it that you are trying to do? There is a fan which draws in air from the surrounding atmosphere through the felt pads that are put all around its surroundings. These felt pads are wetted using water, using a sump of water and a pump which pumps the water onto the felt pads. So the water is in continuous circulation. Okay, it goes, wets the pads and comes back to the sump. Some of the water gets evaporated by the air that flows in. And this air, which is wetted by the felt pads, is thrown into the room. Okay. So what are we doing here? We are adding humidity to the air stream that is coming into the room. Why are we doing that? Because by practical experience, we know that by adding humidity to the air, we are able to bring down the temperature of the air. Right. So the purpose is to get air which is lower in temperature than the surroundings. That's why it's called a cooler, right? And also substantially more humid than the surroundings. This is what we do. So let us try to understand this process. What are we trying to do? This desert cooler, we also understand, is useful when the outside is hot and dry, and we cannot comfortably use it in monsoon. Right? In monsoon, you normally turn the pump off so as to get only a draft of air, but not wet it further, because in monsoon, if you wet the air further, it is already very close to saturation because of the surrounding humidity. Then the room becomes even more humid than the outside, and we are more uncomfortable because of the high temperatures that are typically there. The second reason also is that because the outdoor is already humid, the air does not have too much capacity left. The relative humidity is already high. It's very close to saturation. Phi is very close to 1. That if you saturate it further, if you add more water to the air, the amount of water that it can take is very little, and therefore the amount of cooling that is produced by that water is also little. So you don't get a substantial benefit of temperature, but you get a penalty of humidity. And so in monsoon, it is not a comfortable device to use. Right? So now what is the thermodynamic process that is going on in this system? You throw water onto the felt pads, right? And the air that is coming in picks up this water. The air goes in contact with this water and evaporates the water from the surface of the droplets that are falling down. Okay. The water vapor that evaporates takes away the latent heat of vaporization from the medium that it is in contact with. So it takes the latent heat of vaporization from the liquid droplet and from the air, right? In the process, cooling the liquid droplet as well as the air. This is a very interesting thing that's happening now, right? You are blowing hot air from outside and you are throwing water into it. This water partially evaporates, and this partial evaporation absorbs the heat present in the air as well as the water, thereby getting the temperature of the air lower and the temperature of the water also lower. So if you touch the water that is there in the sump of a cooler after it has run for about an hour, you will find that the water is much cooler than what you get from the tap. The water temperature is substantially lower as compared to your room temperature. Is this an experience? Has anybody done that? Yes. Put your hand into the sump? Yes. You know that it is cooler, right? So this air that is coming into the room not only cools itself by evaporating the moisture, but also cools the water. So this is a very interesting thing that happens, because of which In summer, we prefer to use the desert cooler, and water is a beautiful substance, right, which is available to us in plenty, and if you just throw it into the air, it cools down the air and cools itself also. This process is called, in some sense, a saturation process. What are you trying to do? You are trying to saturate the outdoor air with moisture to whatever extent it can go. Okay. So, strictly speaking, if I had a very thick felt pad and enough residence time provided for the air through the water passage, or enough contact provided between water and the air, such that every particle of air that comes into the room has come into contact with water before it comes into the room, then the air would have reached complete saturation. Right? So, I would have got relative humidity of 1 if the entire air went in contact with the felt pads. Roughly speaking, let us say a fraction of the air gets in contact with the felt pads and goes to saturation, and the remainder of the air does not find any water in the way, so does not get saturated but comes in at the inlet condition, and before it is thrown into the room, because the fan is running there, there is a turbulence. So, these two mix thoroughly and you get a mixture of completely saturated water vapor air mixture and unsaturated water vapor air mixture that is coming from the outdoors into a homogeneous mixture. So, we will get a point which is somewhere in between the starting point and the end point because of the mixing process. Okay. The humidity content that is there in the air that is delivered to the room is neither fully saturated nor fully the outdoor condition, but somewhere in between. Right? You understand the phenomenon now. Now, imagine a situation where this entire desert cooler is insulated so that it does not have any heat transfer with the surroundings. So, the whole process of saturation is adiabatic, then the process is called adiabatic saturation. Right? So, what happens in a desert cooler, if you can neglect the heat transfer that is happening between the surroundings and the water or the air that is coming, you could call this an adiabatic saturator. But because we are not consciously insulating it, it is not an adiabatic saturator, but it is just a saturator. Right? But if I completely insulate that, then it becomes an adiabatic saturation process. Right? So, let us now look at the adiabatic saturation process a little closely. So, what do you have here? You have air coming in at temperature T1, relative humidity phi 1, or in other words specific humidity omega 1, which is characteristic of the outdoor air. Right? So, we can say it has an enthalpy H1. Okay, the outdoor air with the temperature T1, relative humidity phi 1, which correspondingly has the absolute humidity or specific humidity omega 1 and enthalpy H1, is entering the room. It goes through a process where it gets in contact, thorough contact with some water, that every particle of air that comes in touches water before it goes out. Okay. So, it is an ideal process where the entire air comes into contact with water. So, by the time it goes out, this phi 2 would become 100% or 1, phi 2 would become 1, and therefore, in that process there is a change in temperature because of the water evaporating, and therefore, there is T2, omega 2 which is corresponding to the completely saturated condition, and therefore, there is a change in enthalpy. So, if I try to look at it on the psychrometric diagram, okay, what happens? Suppose this is my initial state A, which is rather dry or low in saturation, let us say, okay, and this is the condition where if I make it completely in contact with water, it cools down. So, the temperature comes down from theta A to theta X, and the humidity goes up from GA to GX, let us say, right. So, this is the way the process would go. The specific humidity of the water increases because it picks up water on the way, okay. So, it goes from GA to GX and the temperature goes down from theta A to theta X. So, the air that went in contact with water has reached a state which is X. Initially, the air was at state A, and when the air is completely saturated using the adiabatic saturation process, it reaches a state X, right. In case the contact is not perfect, that is, not all the particles of air that comes in goes in contact with water, then some of the air picks up water on the way and reaches state X. The rest of the air comes in at state A and then finally mix, and depending on how much of air at X and how much of air at A are present during the mixing process, you will have the state point B anywhere between A and X on this line that connects the two. Is that clear? So, this is the process of adiabatic saturation. We will also talk about non-adiabatic saturation in a while, but in the process of adiabatic saturation, I am not adding or removing any heat to this process. The entire energy transfer is internal between the water that is present in the system and the air that is coming into the system, right. So, it is just an energy interchange between the air and water media, and there is no other heat transfer that is happening through the boundaries of the system. Is it clear? So, that is what I call adiabatic saturation. And this process, if I run the desert cooler, for example, continuously for about an hour, will go to a reasonably steady state where the inlet conditions, outlet conditions and the conditions of the water practically become stationary. They don't change, okay. So, that is the process which I would, let us say, call an adiabatic saturation process, which will follow a process starting from point A going towards point X, okay. So, this line, which is decreasing omega and decreasing temperature and increasing omega, characterizes the process of adiabatic saturation, okay. Now, irrespective of what my extent of contact is, whether it is perfect contact, whether it is hardly any contact, whether it is moderate contact, the state point B will always lie on the straight line connecting A and X. Is that correct? If there is no contact at all, the state point will be, B will be coincident with A, and if the contact is perfect, it will be coinciding with X, and anywhere in between, the state point B will lie on the straight line connecting A and X. Let us do another mental exercise. Suppose the state point A is not here, but here on the same straight line, but a little further down. Now, the range over which B can exist has also increased, right. But the interesting part is that all the state points that characterize this adiabatic saturation process, irrespective of the extent of contact, will lie on this one straight line connecting the starting state point to a corresponding saturation state point on the saturation line, right. So, this line has some parameter that is constant on it, okay. This is a line that is characterizing this, or let me put it in another words, any state point on this line, whether it is A, B, C, D, anything that is on that straight line, when it goes through an adiabatic saturation process to complete saturation, will always reach the state point X, okay. So, if I say the temperature theta X at X is one specific temperature, then that will be the end temperature for all the state points that lie on that line connecting A and X, even extended further towards this side. any state point on that line Ax will always end up at x. Okay. So, if I call theta x the adiabatic saturation temperature, then for all the state points that are lying on Abx, whether it is extended this way or in between the two, interpolated or extrapolated, all these state points have the same adiabatic saturation temperature. Right? So, this is the concept of adiabatic saturation that I wanted you to understand. Now, suppose I put a thermometer here, and I put a small piece of cloth or cotton around the bulb of the thermometer and keep it wet. Okay? So, the cloth or the cotton that is put around the bulb of the thermometer is wetted with water, it is kept wet. What will the thermometer read? As air passes over it, the contact between air and water is at the point of saturation, which is at point x, because point x is where the liquid and vapor are in equilibrium, that is why it is on the saturation line. Right? So, the air and the water that is on the wick are in saturation, and therefore, the temperature of the wick, the temperature of the water in the wick would be theta x. So, this thermometer with the wet wick that I put in the air stream will read temperature theta x or the adiabatic saturation temperature. If I put another thermometer without any wet wick on it, the bulb is dry, then it would read the temperature theta a of the air that comes in, or theta b after the mixing point, depending on where I put it. If I put it at the inlet, it would read theta a. If I put it after the saturation, it would read theta b. Okay. The temperature theta b or theta a would be read by the temperature of the thermometer, which does not have a wet wick on it because it reads the surrounding temperature. But the moment I put a wet wick on it, the water liquid in this wick, because it is a very thin film, I do not expect too much of temperature difference between the surface of water and the surface of the glass. This whole liquid goes to the temperature theta x, and therefore my the thermometer, so long as the wick is thin and the water film is thin, I will be able to read the adiabatic saturation temperature. So, if I put two thermometers there, one without the wick, wet wick, and the other with the wet wick, I call this the wet bulb thermometer and this the dry bulb thermometer. I put two thermometers, the wet bulb and the dry bulb thermometers, in the air stream at any given position. It would read the adiabatic saturation temperature of the air and the actual temperature of the air at that position. So, if I call it the dry bulb temperature and the wet bulb temperature, then the temperature of the air which I plot on the x axis is actually the dry bulb temperature. And the corresponding adiabatic saturation temperature to any of these state points would be the wet bulb temperature. So, I can actually measure the adiabatic saturation temperature using a thermometer with a wet wick. And therefore, I can get what is the wet bulb temperature and the dry bulb temperature at a given location using these two thermometers. Okay. Now, what is the advantage of this? Suppose the state point A is not here, but here, then its adiabatic saturation temperature would be on a line which is connecting this point to the saturation line, not coincident with this line, because any point on this line will always reach x, but any point outside this line will reach a different point x prime here. Right? So, for any state point in this space with a given dry bulb temperature, there will always be a wet bulb temperature. Okay? So, I can actually draw the psychrometric diagram with dry bulb temperature here, the saturation line here, omega here, and lines of constant wet bulb temperature. Right? So, I can draw the psychrometric diagram for dry bulb temperature on the x axis, omega on the y axis, and an axis of wet bulb temperatures which is slanted like this, right. So, if I measure a wet bulb temperature and a dry bulb temperature, I locate a state point, and therefore, I know at what state in the psychrometric diagram it is. If I can locate that point on the psychrometric diagram, then I can correspondingly read the value of omega, read the value of phi, and read the value of enthalpy, which will also be very similar to the WBT line. I will show you what the relation between the enthalpy line and the WBT line in a while, but then the measurement of the wet bulb and dry bulb temperature gives me a method of locating the state point of air on the psychrometric diagram. You tell me. Why should the slopes be enormously different, or would the lines intersect if at all? Yes, provided they are on the same line connecting the initial point to the saturation point, right. So, suppose I start from this point and reach this saturation point, any point that is on this line will always reach this point. But another point which is starting here, why would that reach the same point?
Why can't it reach the same
point? You tell me. Or let us do this exercise. That question leads me to non-adiabatic saturation. If I start from here, but the water that I put in this, I am not going to insulate it, but I am going to put a small heater and heat that water. What will happen? This water will be warmer, and therefore it will not take you towards the saturation line this way, but it will take you on a line which is not so parallel to it, right. So, the process of non-adiabatic saturation will take you to lines which are not parallel to this, but away from this line. But so long as the process is adiabatic, the adiabatic saturation temperature behaves like a thermodynamic temperature, and therefore it depends only on the point, state point. It cannot be reached by the same process from different starting points, which are not on the same adiabatic saturation line. So, if I start from here, I will only reach a line that is here. So, all of these wet bulb temperature lines would be parallel to each other. You can experimentally verify that, okay. But if I start from a given state point and my adiabatic saturation leads me this way, if I have to go away from this line, from this point, then I will have to go this way or this way, which would basically mean that when I saturate, the temperature of the air is higher than adiabatic or lower than adiabatic, right. This is my adiabatic, this is the temperature. The temperature would be, sorry, the omega would be either higher or lower in this case, or if I take this line, the temperature would be lower or higher in this case as compared to the adiabatic saturation. So, if the temperature has to be lower than adiabatic saturation, then it has to be subadiabatic, which means that you need to remove heat, and if the temperature has to be super adiabatic, you need to add heat. So, in the water sump, if I put either a cooling coil or an electric heater, I will be able to get the other slopes, but if I do not put anything, if I just have it adiabatic, then I will get only the single slope that I have given you, right. So, that is the reason why. From any state point, see, if my argument is, if I start from this point and I can say reach the same point as starting from this point, then I am actually saying that from this point I can either go this way or go this way or go this way, there is no unique path. For an adiabatic process that is not feasible, right. So, it has to be a unique path when I have an adiabatic process, right. So, the path can be only different only when the process deviates from adiabatic condition, that is, if I am heating or cooling the water in the sump, which is also a process commonly utilized, okay.
So, these are constant enthalpy lines.
Not yet. I will tell you what the difference is. I will come back to the relationship between constant WBT lines and constant enthalpy lines. They look very similar. They are very close to each other actually, okay. But I will tell you what the difference is. I will come to that, okay. So, now, yeah. That is because when I use a wet wick, the water in the wick has a very thin film, and that film of water goes to equilibrium with the air that is in contact with it. Because when air goes in contact with it, the water evaporates. So in the interface between the air and the water, the liquid vapor equilibrium exists. Just like we studied yesterday on the liquid surface where the vapor is in contact, the vapor is in saturation, it exerts saturation vapor pressure. The same thing happens on the liquid film on the bulb. So when it is in equilibrium, it is at the equilibrium temperature, which is corresponding to the saturation line. Right? So that is the reason why the bulb always experiences the temperature of equilibrium between the liquid and vapor. So the wet bulb temperature reads the saturation temperature. Is that clear? Where is non-adiabatic saturation used? Adiabatic saturation we can understand, all right, we can even neglect the heat gain by the desert cooler from the surroundings and say it is an adiabatic process, right. Non-adiabatic saturation, where is it used? One example is the cooling towers that you see. The cooling towers that you see in your air conditioning plants or the DG set plants in the institute, where the cooling water of the condenser in the air conditioning plants or cooling water of the engine in the DG sets, this water has to be cooled. So what do? You spray this water and run a fan to send the atmospheric air. So the atmospheric air evaporates part of this water and cools the rest of the water down. This water therefore is not adiabatic, but it is taken through a heat exchanger to which heat is added, to in which the heat is added to the water. So this is one example of non-adiabatic saturation process which is commonly used everywhere. There is another example where in, for example, large halls, let us say factories, in summer you would like to maintain the temperature low, but you do not want to spend heavily on an air conditioning system. So the one option you have is a desert cooler, but desert cooler is not very effective and not effective in all seasons. So what is done is to use chilled water in the desert cooler. Do not use water at room temperature, but chill the water using a small refrigeration plant, get the chilled water and spray it onto the pads. So the air that comes out will now be cooler than the air that would come out of the adiabatic saturation process, and therefore if you want to cool a large space, if you want to use water at room temperature, you will need a much larger cooler, but a smaller cooler would be able to effectively keep the place comfortable if I use a small air conditioning plant, a small refrigeration plant to cool the water. So now what do? We are actually taking the water that is being sprayed through a chiller, so remove heat from that and then bring it in. So this is another process of non-adiabatic saturation on the other side. So this is the sub-adiabatic saturation process, which is used in what is called the air washers. This device where you wash the water with chilled, wash the air with chilled water is called air washers. These are the low cost air cooling systems for large factory halls and places like that where you would like to keep the temperatures moderate in summer. Okay. So these are two examples of non-adiabatic saturation process. And the adiabatic saturation process, a typical example is the desert cooler, which is very closely adiabatic, and the adiabatic saturation is a thermodynamic process which can be characterized by a constant wet bulb temperature line. So any state point on this line will have the same wet bulb temperature, and therefore these lines are called constant wet bulb temperature lines. So we denote this as dry bulb temperature dBT and this as the wet bulb temperature wBT. So dBT and wBT are popular acronyms used for dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature in psychrometry. Now to the next question, what is the relationship between enthalpy and wet bulb temperature? Is a constant wBT line also a constant enthalpy line? For that, we will need to look at the first law for this system where adiabatic saturation is happening. M dot A is flowing in and out of the adiabatic saturator. This is an adiabatic saturator. Okay. It is coming in with an enthalpy H1 of the mixture and going out with an enthalpy H2 of the mixture, coming in with omega 1 and going out with omega 2 specific humidity. Okay. So, if I write the first law for this system in steady state steady flow, what is happening? It is picking up some water which is at an enthalpy HF. So, some amount of water is picked up and therefore, the mass that goes out, you have m dot A into 1 plus omega 1 is the mass flow rate of the mixture that is coming in, because m dot A into omega 1 is the mass of water vapor that is coming in and m dot A is the mass of air that is coming in. So, m dot A into 1 plus omega 1 is the total mass of the mixture that is coming in. Right, this is m dot A plus m dot V. Is that clear? At the inlet state. The same thing, m dot A into omega 2 plus 1 will be the mass that is going out. So, the change in mass of the mixture is omega 2 minus omega 1 into m dot A. Right. So, you will have, this is inflow, out is m dot A into 1 plus omega 2. Right. So, if I write the mass balance, the outflowing mass flow is slightly higher than the incoming mass flow by the amount of water vapor between these two. So, m dot A into omega 1 plus omega 2 minus m dot A into 1 plus omega 1 is the delta m F, if I call it, where F stands for the liquid water, okay, because we use HF for liquid water. I am also using m dot F for the liquid water. So, this delta m F of liquid water is getting added at an enthalpy of HF. So, if I write the energy balance, what will I get? Incoming energy is m dot A into H1, right, because H1 is the specific enthalpy of the mixture per unit mass of dry air, right. So, if I multiply by mass of dry air, then that is the incoming enthalpy. Outgoing enthalpy is m dot A into H2, let us say. So, the difference between these two is the energy added by the water that is getting added. Okay. So, the difference between these two, m dot A into H2 minus H1 is therefore delta m F into HF. Is that correct? Because the whole thing is adiabatic, there is no heat transfer in or out. There is stream coming in, there is stream going out. The only difference between these two is the mass picked up, and the mass has an enthalpy HF and specific enthalpy HF, and therefore, the difference between these two enthalpies is going to be delta MF times HF. I divide throughout by m dot A, I will get H2 minus H1 is equal to delta MF by m dot A into HF. And what is this delta MF by MA? Delta MF is nothing but m dot A into omega 2 minus omega 1, right. So, if I substitute that there, I will get omega 2 minus omega 1 times HF, right. So, now I know that H2 and H1 are not the same. Okay. So, now let me go back to the psychrometric diagram. If I am looking at an adiabatic saturation with state 1 here and state 2 here, okay, which is completely saturated, then H2 is not equal to H1, but it is greater than H1 by a small quantity. Okay. So, if I draw a constant enthalpy line at 2, it will be something like this, and constant enthalpy line at 1 it will be something like this. This is H2 and this is H1, and the difference between the two is going to be delta omega into HF, where delta omega is omega 2 minus omega 1 multiplied by HF. This HF is a very small quantity because the enthalpy of liquid water in comparison with the enthalpy of water vapor is very small. If you look at the steam tables, HF would be of the order of 100, 150, whereas the HG would be of the order of 2500, 2600, right. So, HF is a small quantity as compared to the H1 and H2, and therefore, this difference will be very small. Okay. So, a constant WBT line is very nearly a constant enthalpy line, but not quite so. In the process of adiabatic saturation, there is a very small increase in enthalpy, and therefore, H2 is slightly larger than H1. So, if I look at constant enthalpy lines and constant WBT lines, there will be a clear change of slope. The constant WBT lines will have a slightly higher slope as compared to the constant enthalpy lines. Is that clear? Okay, so, if you look at the psychrometric chart, visually it is very difficult to make out the difference between constant enthalpy lines and constant WBT lines. So, you will need to carefully follow the scales given for WBT and enthalpy, and that is when you actually find that out. So, let me just show you a typical psychrometric chart, so you can figure out the various things. Are you able to see something there? Okay. Let me just show you that this scale on the x axis is dry bulb temperature. It is a little too tiny to be able to see, but okay. Dry bulb temperature, and what is on the y axis is called the humidity ratio or specific humidity. Okay. So, the units of humidity ratio, that is MV by MA or specific humidity, could be in kilograms per kilogram, which is non-dimensional, kilograms of water per kilogram of dry air, or it could be in grams per kilogram, grams of water per kilogram of dry air, because kilogram per kilogram will be a very small number. So, sometimes you use grams per kilogram, right. So, the humidity ratio, you can see here, you have numbers like 10, 12, 14, 16. If I bring it back to the original size, right, how big can it get? Okay. So, you have a number that is starting at 0 here and going on up to about 30 grams per kg on the y axis, while the x axis goes from a dry bulb temperature of 0 to 50 degrees Celsius. Okay. These are lines of constant relative humidity, you can see them, right. So, if I magnify it a little bit, you see that 10% relative humidity, 20%, 30%, 40%, right. So, it would be written on one of those lines, and the other lines that look similar to that are lines of constant relative humidity. So, 10% is phi is equal to 0.1, 20% is phi is equal to 0.2, and so on. Right. The other quantity is enthalpy, who has a scale here which is outside the psychrometric chart. Right. The enthalpy is marked here 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, etcetera, in kilojoules per kg of dry air. Okay. And a complementary scale is there on the other side, which is, again, you can see the slanted markings here. Okay. So, it goes like 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, 110, 120. Right. So, the way to read it is, you have to use the ruler, connect this graduation to the corresponding graduation here. So, any line in between, any point in between will be on your ruler. Okay. So, if you have a point that is there on your psychrometric diagram, you put a ruler between the two ends of the enthalpy value passing through this point, so that it has the same reading on the enthalpy line on both sides, then that will be a value of enthalpy. Right? If I have the psychrometric diagram like this, I am sorry, like this, you have a state point here and there is an enthalpy scale here and there is an enthalpy scale here. Enthalpy scale here, right? So what you need to do is to put a ruler falling on this point such that the reading here and the reading here on the ruler are the same. So here also it reads 50, here also it reads 50, and the ruler passes through that point, then the enthalpy at that point is 50. If you put the scale theta, then here it will be 60 and here it will be 40, that will not be correct, right? So that is what I was trying to say. So you need to use a ruler to be able to point the enthalpy, because the enthalpy lines are not drawn through the psychrometric diagram. You can see that only the larger enthalpy lines, that is the tens or maybe twos and fours, may be drawn through, but not all of them, because that would clutter with the WBT lines. The WBT lines are normally drawn through. The WBT scale is on the saturation line. You have to switch between this, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the WBT line, the scale is on the saturation line. Okay. It says saturation temperature degree Celsius. That is your wet bulb temperature. So 5, 10, 15, 20. These are the lines that you see. This is 15, this is 20. These are the lines. This is 15. These dotted lines that you see here, 15. And then this is 20 and so on. So these are the lines of constant WBT. And a constant enthalpy line you can see is here. The 50 line is coming through. And this is the WBT line of, count it, it is 15, 16, 17, 18. This is 18 degrees Celsius WBT. And this is enthalpy 50. Right? So you can see the two lines very close to each other. So that is the reason why the enthalpy lines are not drawn through the diagram, except for the major lines like tens and fives. And WBT, you normally have every 1 degree there is a dotted line that is drawn. Okay, you should be able to distinguish the two. That is the reason why the line types are different. The WBT lines are drawn in dotted here, and the enthalpy lines are drawn in full lines. So now, using this psychrometric diagram, you should be able to actually read any state point if I know two of the properties. So if I, for example, measure the wet bulb and dry bulb temperature from my psychrometric chart, I say the dry bulb temperature is 30 degrees Celsius, wet bulb temperature is 18 degrees Celsius. Then I draw the ordinate, 30 degree dry bulb temperature, 18 degree wet bulb temperature from here, wherever they meet is the state point. And at that point, I can read the value of omega, I can read the value of H, I can read the value of another variable which I have not talked to you about, which is the specific volume. Right? So these lines, where is it written there? Okay. It's not written anywhere. I'll just tell you. These lines which are steeper, okay? If I skip to here, if this is your WBT line and your enthalpy line, which is slightly less shallow than that, this is H line and this is W line, okay? Or rather, this is the H line and therefore the W line is, WBT line is slightly steeper. The enthalpy, the constant specific volume lines are much steeper than that. Okay, this is the specific volume of the mixture, which is the volume of the mixture per unit mass of dry air, okay, which will be very close to the specific volume of air because the water vapor quantity is very small, but there is still a modification of the specific volume because of the addition of water vapor. So you read that from here. Okay, we can actually prove that specific volume of the mixture can be calculated from the dry air. It will be the VA corresponding to PA and T. Okay, this is something that you can prove. VA is nothing but, or R air into T by P air, where PA is the partial pressure of air, dry air. Okay, this can be proven. I am not going to go into details of that. You can prove it by just using the ideal gas law for ideal gas mixtures. So the V mixture is equal to VA. That is, the specific volume of the air water vapor mixture at the atmospheric pressure would be equal to the specific volume of dry air at the partial pressure of dry air. Is something that you can prove, okay, straight away using the ideal gas laws. So this V mix is what you see here on the lines which are steeper. So if I switch back here, these shallower lines, these dotted lines are WBT lines, and the full complete dark lines are enthalpy lines, and these lines which are steeper than that, these ones, this is 0.82, 0.83, 0.84, 0.85, 0.86 and so on. These lines are the constant specific volume line. So on that line, whatever is the value written there, that is the specific volume of air at that state, right. So you can actually get all the state points, all the properties at the state point once you know two of those properties. So if I know dry bulb temperature and omega, or dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature, any two properties, or dry bulb temperature and phi, I should be able to locate the point on the psychrometric diagram and read the other properties from the psychrometric chart. One thing to remember is the psychrometric chart is plotted for one particular pressure, and that is normally written at the top of the psychrometric chart. So let us so it says normal temperature, which is 0 to 50 degrees Celsius, and sea level. So the barometric pressure is given to be 101.325 kilopascals. So this entire psychrometric diagram is valid for that pressure. If the pressure is different, then you need to either look for a different psychrometric diagram or go back to basics and calculate from the formula that you have. Is that clear? So that is about psychrometry that I wanted to introduce. So I will take a pause here, take questions. I said the specific volume V mix which can be written as R mix, sorry, the R universal gas constant divided by the molecular weight of the mixture into T divided by pressure, right. I can also write specific volume of air in the mixture is universal gas constant divided by molecular weight of dry air into T by PA. Okay. What I can go ahead and show is that since this R and T are fixed for both the cases, the relationship between M mix and P and MA and PA is such that these two are equal. So I just said that the specific volume of the mixture at the atmospheric pressure is equal to the specific volume of dry air at its partial pressure in the same mixture. Okay, that you can go ahead and show. That's what I said. Yeah. Slightly different. I'll show you one line where it looks actually different. Can you look at this pair of lines? One is the enthalpy line, the other is WBT line. You can see the divergence there. That is the kind of angle that you have. That's why I said visually you cannot make out that angle unless you see those lines close to each other. But otherwise, if you just see this line and this line, they look almost the same, almost parallel. But this is the kind of angle that you have, about half a degree between them or 1 degree between them. That's the kind of angle that you see. Okay. So that's because the HF value is so small as compared to the H1, H2 values, that the omega, delta omega into HF contributes only that much of a change to the enthalpy. Even if I go from, for example, this state to this state, the enthalpy would have only changed by this much, small difference. Yeah.
So why doing energy calculation while obtaining the relation H2 minus H1 is equal to omega 2 minus omega 1 HF? Then you took energy in MA dot into H1. then that's the energy of only dry air, no? It's not.
Please go back to the previous class notes and see what is the definition of specific enthalpy in this one. It's always defined in terms of per unit mass of dry air. It is the enthalpy of the mixture divided by the mass of dry air, right? So if H1 is enthalpy per unit mass of dry air, I should only multiply it by dry air to get the total enthalpy. So there is no approximation there. Any other?
So why you haven't considered the change in enthalpy of water? Will it change or what?
Initially it will. Say for example, if I fill the tank of a desert cooler with atmospheric temperature water and start running the cooler, as the cooler runs, its water will go on decreasing, its temperature will go on decreasing. But after a certain period of time, it will go to equilibrium and the temperature of the water will actually be equal to the adiabatic saturation temperature if the whole thing is adiabatic. Okay, so the theta x will be the temperature of that sump after some time. So once it reaches the adiabatic saturation temperature, it will not change any further. So you can take that HF to be a constant at steady state. Initial transients, it will change from the room temperature to the adiabatic saturation temperature, but after that it will remain constant. Okay. So in technically rigorous discussion, you say that the water will get exhausted. So you normally put a makeup water which will come in at its adiabatic saturation temperature, so that there is real adiabaticity. Any other questions? Okay, so now that we have understood psychrometry, let me talk about a few psychrometric processes that are commonly used in air conditioning. Okay, so we'll take a few of those processes to start with. When we do air conditioning, we are not talking about just cooling the air, but we are also talking about controlling the temperature, controlling the humidity, and also controlling the freshness of the air. Typically, air conditioning would mean all of these, in the sense that if the same room air is taken, cooled, and conditioned and put back into the room, the temperature and humidity are controlled, but the odor that might start because of the presence, the occupancy, or the devices that are there in the room would affect the freshness of the air. Okay, if you have 100 people breathing inside the room, the carbon dioxide content of the air would go on increasing, the oxygen content would go on depleting, right? So you need to replace it with fresh air. If you have a warm, wet season, a lot of people sweat, so there is a lot of water molecules added to it along with the odor of the sweat. So in order to keep the room fresh, it is not just necessary to control the temperature and humidity, but you also need to control the freshness of the air. So these are the things that are commonly done in an air conditioning process. So in air conditioner, what do? Room air conditioner is okay. You just put a cooling coil inside the room, take the room air and breathe through it. So it just cools and circulates it back, and you have the doors and windows which are not completely sealed. So some amount of fresh air keeps coming in and going out. You might have some possibility of ventilation in the air conditioning itself. But then what normally is required is to be able to take the room air out, throw out part of it, replace part of it with fresh air, and then pass this whole mixture through a cooling coil, if necessary through a humidifying coil or a dehumidifier, control the humidity, control the temperature, and then put it back into the room. So what are the processes that you see? So it could be cooling, it could be even heating. In winter, if you want to maintain the temperature, instead of a cooling coil, you would have a heater, right? So you would have heating, you would have cooling, you would have humidification, you would have dehumidification, you would have mixing. These are five very common processes that is there in air conditioning. In any AC plant that you might see, not talking about simple single door window units or single split units in the room, but if you talk about a complete air conditioner, say you visit the air conditioning plant of the library or computer services center or the Dogra Hall, you will find all of these things there in place. Okay. So let us try to understand what are those processes. So, the simplest of those processes, so I will also draw the corresponding psychrometric diagram for each of those processes. So, this is dBT omega and the saturation line. Okay. Suppose this is my starting point, okay. Say point 1. What happens if I take this air through a heater? I take this air through a heater, increase its temperature and then let it out. So, in heating process, what changes? The dry bulb temperature would increase, and what would happen to the humidity? Humidity will not change. There is no water getting added or removed. So, the specific humidity will not change. Okay. So, what will be the process then? It will be a horizontal line from this point towards the right. Right. So, this we call it sensible heating. Why do we call it sensible heating? To distinguish it from latent heat, which will be actually due to addition or removal of moisture. You say sensible heating is pure heating without addition of moisture or removal of moisture. Okay. Similarly, I can also have sensible cooling. If I have a cooling coil over which the air is passed, then the air cools down, its temperature goes down, but I do not remove any moisture. There is a catch to it, I will tell you about that, but then if I go from here to here, it is sensible cooling. What is the catch that I have? If it goes on cooling until here, then what happens? It gets saturated, and if I try to cool it any further, condensation starts taking place and the moisture will change. So, the cooling does not remain sensible, it becomes cooling plus dehumidification. Right? So, this temperature is commonly called the dew point. Okay, do not write DUE. The DU, DEW means the droplets of water that start condensing. So, early morning on the blades of grass on that you see, the water droplets that are condensed, in English we call it dew, right. Those dew droplets start getting formed on any cold surface which is exposed to moist air, if the temperature of that surface is lower than the corresponding dew point temperature. Okay. So, for any state, let us say state 1, there is a dew point temperature, where I can actually draw a line horizontally from that point until it reaches the saturation line. The point at which, the temperature at which this meeting happens of this horizontal line with the saturation line is called the dew point temperature. Okay. So, the dew point temperature is a property of the air. Okay. So, any state of air along this horizontal line will have this dew point temperature. Any state of air along this horizontal line will have this dew point temperature, and so on. Right? So, if the cooling process happens using a coil whose temperature is higher than or equal to the dew point temperature, let us not say equal, it is higher than dew point temperature, then the cooling is sensible cooling. Okay? So, that is the catch that I said. For heating, there is no such qualifier. Okay. I can go on heating it because there is increasing capacity to hold water. You can go on heating it sensibly to any temperature. But sensible cooling can only happen down up to the dew point temperature, below which you cannot prevent dehumidification. So, if I have a cooling coil whose temperature is lower than the dew point temperature of the incoming air, then condensation is inevitable. You cannot avoid. Okay, so, even if you do not want to remove moisture, the moisture will get removed and you might need to re-add the moisture separately in another process. Okay, so, that is why process of cooling and dehumidification is always spoken together. You always say cooling and dehumidification as a single process, because usually you cannot ensure that your cooling coils are always at temperatures above the dew point, because the dew point depends on the inlet air condition, right? The amount of moisture or the kind of temperature at which the inlet air is coming in would determine its dew point, and therefore you cannot always design a system such that the cooling is always sensible, okay? And more often than not, the cooling always is accompanied by dehumidification, because your coil temperatures are lower than the dew point temperature of air in most of the cases, right? So cooling and dehumidification is another process. So we talked about sensible heating as one process, sensible cooling as one process, and cooling and dehumidification as the third process. Let us try to understand cooling and dehumidification on a separate diagram. Okay, you start here, let us say state 1, and your coil temperature is somewhere here. Okay, so if I make this air to come in contact with this coil, what will happen? The air that comes in contact with the coil first will go through sensible cooling up to its dew point, and after that it will move along this line. Why should it? Because moisture goes on condensing as its temperature goes down, and therefore it will be going along the equilibrium line. This is the state of the air that is in contact with the coil. We discussed the felt pads, where some of the air could be in contact with the felt pad water and some of the air could just go through without coming in contact with the water. The same thing can happen in coils also. You pass air over a coil, some fraction of the air comes in intimate contact with the coil and follows this state, and some fraction of the air does not come in contact with the coil and therefore comes out at this state. Okay. So the end state of air in contact is, let us say, C, and in the beginning state is A. Then the air that is coming out of the cooling and dehumidifying coil will have its state on the straight line connecting these two points, anywhere in between, because it will be a mixture of this air and this air in different proportions depending on how much of the coil came in, how much of the air came in contact with the coil. Okay. So you call it the coil contact factor, or you also have another term called the coil bypass factor. So the coil contact factor is the fraction of the air that came in contact with the coil during the process of cooling. So the fraction of the air that is at state C in terms of mass flow rate of the air. So suppose I have m dot A as the mass flow rate of dry air, okay, out of which let us say m dot A1 came in perfect contact with the coil, and m dot A minus m dot A1 bypassed the coil. So this contacted the coil and this bypassed. Then m dot A1 by m dot A is called the coil contact factor, okay, and m dot A minus m dot A1 by m dot A is called the coil bypass factor.
The third subpart of the air have a state other than A and C midway on the path.
What we idealize it as is that this much of air went in contact and became state C, this much of air didn't touch it and came at state A, and after that mixed. It could be either way, but when the air comes out, it would be at a state somewhere between A and C. So we can always mark cooling and dehumidification process by a straight line connecting the starting point to the saturation condition at the coil temperature. This coil temperature is also called the apparatus dew point. Okay. at this state. So, state C is usually called the apparatus dew point, which is at a temperature of the coil TC, T coil, and saturated. Okay. So, you will always connect in a cooling and dehumidification process the starting state with the apparatus dew point by a straight line, and then take off a fraction which is corresponding to the coil bypass factor or the coil contact factor. This will be corresponding to the coil contact factor, this will be corresponding to the coil bypass factor. So, if the coil contact factor is 70%, you will be marking this point 70% from here. If the coil bypass factor is 30%, you will be marking this point 30% from here. Is that clear? So, that is called the cooling and dehumidification process. We will stop this lecture here. Okay. We will continue this discussion in the next class.